Troy. Early in the morning, just trying to let the sun in and open up my eyes.
And now I'm gonna use this. If I get too loud, just tell me to chill. And if I need to get louder, also tell me. So, has anyone not come to one of my reviews before? Welcome, I'm G, and I do different problems than what was given on the practice test, because those are all covered in Ryan's reviews. So please go to that tomorrow if you're interested in seeing how to solve those. But I'll just go ahead and hop right into what I think is going to be on the test. And I divided this review into two parts. Half of it is going to be magnetism, and the other half is going to be circuits, primarily resistors and Kirchhoff's rules. So did everyone watch the right-hand rule and Lenz's law video? Raise your hand if you did not watch that.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I forgot.
So I'm not going to, it'll take, those videos are pretty short, so I would say definitely watch them tonight or tomorrow night before the test anytime, but I'm not going to replay those videos live for you right now. When I get to a problem that uses Lenz's law on the right-hand rule, I'll explain it. If it doesn't make sense, ask, and I'll do some examples, but hopefully you watch those, and things should follow pretty easily if you did. So we'll go ahead and start with magnetism, which includes magnetic forces on charged moving particles, magnetic forces on wires, magnetic fields, and induction, which is the problem you guys did today in class. This was the question that I had answered from you guys. Happy you didn't answer. But so we'll get started. This was a multiple choice question from two semesters ago. And I expect something of this sort to be tested again. You're given a charged particle with a velocity, and it's moving in a magnetic field. They could ask you one of just a couple things. If they give you the force and the velocity, they're going to ask for the magnetic field, like in this problem. But they could give you the velocity and the magnetic field and ask for the force. Sometimes they'll give you all three vector quantities and ask for the charge. But all of it goes down to being able to use this equation for a force on a charged particle with a velocity and a magnetic field. So the force is qv cross b, and it's given to you on your equation sheet. So let's see what we're given in this problem. They tell us the velocity is 2 in the x direction, 4 in the y direction, and 6 in the z direction. And that's in meters per second. And then they happen to give us what the force vector is equal to, which is 4 in the x direction, negative 20 in the y direction, and 12 in the z direction. And that's in our standard units of newtons. And lastly, they tell us that the charge is 20 coulombs. But there's another bit of information in here that we need, otherwise this problem wouldn't be solvable. So what we're tasked to find is the Z component of the magnetic field. Okay, we know F, we know B, we know Q. We can work with this equation. There's four variables, we know three of them. But they tell us that the X component of the magnetic field is equal to 0. And does it tell you that on here?
No.
They tell you right from the problem on the test. So I think when I did this last year, I tried to solve it without that. And that's impossible to do. So now you know. This should be on something. So once we have that bit of information, we have to work with this cross product equation. So the left side is the force. I'm just going to save room and marker ink. So that's the left side. QB cross B is equal to this determinant. So is this how you guys usually do cross products?
Yeah.
Okay. So I know she does it differently with like I dot J. So I think this is the easiest way. So the first vector in the equation is V. We fill that in on this row, 2, 4, 6. The second vector is the magnetic field, where we know the x component is nothing, but we don't know the y or the z component. So I'm going to leave them as variables, by and bz. And I'll just go ahead and fill in the charge. And, should be 2 coulombs. So here's Q. So left side equals right side. Have you guys ever heard that before? There's a Russian math teacher here called Dr. Pinsky, who teaches partial differential equations. It's like a super complex class, and all he says is the left side equals the right side. But we'll use that here. So here's Q, there's 2. This determinant, we have I times 4bz. Minus 6 times by. Then we do minus j. This is important. We take 2 times bz minus 0 times 6. And then plus k hat times the k aspect of this, which is 2 times by minus 0 times 4, just 2 by. So what's our golden rule for Dr. Pinsky? Left side equals the right side. We see we need our y component on the left to equal our y component on the right. And so this kind of convoluted setup gets us to the fact that negative 20 is equal to Q times negative j hat 2b. Everyone see where I'm getting this from? So we know they're both y components. So this tells us negative 20 is negative 4 bz. It's a little bit of arithmetic. Bz is then just 5. And it should be in Tesla. And positive. Is this okay with everyone? So if you don't usually do the cross products this way, you do it whatever way you want, you'll be able to get the same answer.
Okay, so what is the question asking to find the magnetic force in the x-direction?
Yeah, this is what the question is. Is that not even on the slide?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Great. So for those of you, this is your first review with me. I don't think this even happens, but it happened. So yeah, we're asked to find the z component of the magnetic field. It says the magnetic field on the I gave you most of it. Okay, so if that's good, we'll go ahead and do a somewhat similar one. This time, we're given the mass and charge of particle, the velocity, but instead of the magnetic force, we're given the magnetic field and asked to find the acceleration. So the velocity is 20 or 2 kilometers per second in the x direction. So I'm just going to convert that into meters. So 2 times 10 to the 3 meters per second. And that's in along the x-axis, so just in the x-axis. The magnetic field is 234 in the x, y, and z direction, respectively. Then we're given a charge of -6 microcoulombs and a mass of 2 milligrams, which is 2 times 10 to the -6 kilograms. But ultimately, we want the acceleration vector. But all we know is when we have a charged particle moving in magnetic field, this force is what is acting on it. So we need to use that new physics 181 equation. F is qv cross b. And think back to physics 180 and even high school physics, that the force is equal to mass times the acceleration. So all we have to do is compute the cross product, because we're given q, b, and b, divide by the mass, and we have the desired answer. So do you guys want me to do that cross product? No. There was at least one yes, so I'll do it. Q is -6. This is in coulombs. And then b cross b, we have I. V is just 2 times 10 to the 3 in the x direction and no other direction. And then B is 2, 3, and 4 in x, y, and z. So I times 0 times 4 is 0, minus 3 times 0 is nothing. We have no I component. Minus the j component, we take 2 times 10 to the 3 times 4, and then subtract 2 times 0, and we just get 8 times 10 to the 3. And then z component, is that still there? It is. It's 6 times 10 to the 3. So this is the force. Get acceleration. Oh, there's also this q here. To get the acceleration, we just divide by the mass, which is what? And I get this way in. In there because you're going to have to do, you're going to have to work with this equation all the time. And it's most seen in a multiple choice form like this, where you're computing that cross product. But it's never just as easy as computing v cross b and multiplying by q. In the first problem, we had to solve for a component of the magnetic field. In this problem, we were asked for acceleration. And so it's going to be somewhat convoluted, but at the root of it is being able to use this. Alright. So here is another typical multiple choice question. This one has been on the past board exam, but I think she might move away from this, but the same concept is probably going to be tested. Do you know how to use the right-hand rule to get a magnetic field due to a current? So we have two currents. Here's I. And then a point P in space. And it should be like an equilateral triangle, but I don't think I did it justice in that PowerPoint slide. So both the currents are coming out of the page, and you have to choose which of those letters on that compass represent the direction of the magnetic field at point P. I guess I'll give you 30 seconds to see if you guys can get this on your own. Same thing for the second current. If it was directly underneath, it'd be pointing that way. It's a little to the south.
Okay, yeah, so.
And so the sum of these two vectors is going to be pointing directly to my right, your guys' right, which is east. So, well done, thanks for playing. No prizes here, but I guess you got it. Hey, does this make sense?
Yeah.
So really, try to draw those circles on your test if you get a problem like that. All right. Key is it? So this is a calculation-based problem, also for currents and magnetic fields, but this in particular wants to know the force on one wire that carries a current due to a neighboring wire that also carries a current. So when you guys learn this in class, you learn that the general principle that opposites attract is actually not right, because in this case, if we have, say, I1 going one way and I2 going the other way, these oppose each other. Is that how you spell it? And if they're going in the same direction, they attract. So if they're going in the same direction, the wires are going to be pulled together. And if you flip one of the currents, they're going to be pushed apart from each other. I should probably not have written that in red. There it is. So here, we're given a configuration of three wires. There's wire A that's going into the page. And then at a distance 2R to the right of it, there's wire B coming out of the page. And then one more distance up to the right of B is a third wire, C, with the current also coming out of the page. They tell us what the value of R is, and they ask, what is the force on a 4-meter segment of wire A? And that's when we use our force per unit length equation for the force on one wire due to a current in another wire. It's equal to mu zero, the permeability of free space, times the current in the wire you're talking about, times the current in the other wire, all over 2 pi times A, which is the distance between the two wires. So before we go ahead and use this, we know that, this question that I didn't put in it, it's gonna ask for the direction of that force as well. So let's go ahead and see which way wire A is going to be pushed or pulled. So if we ignore wire C for a second, are these two wires going to attract each other or repel each other? They're going to oppose each other. So here's the force from wire B. And then let's ignore wire B. What is wire C going to do to wire A? Attract or oppose? Oppose. So this is coming out of the page, wire A is going in. So it's also going to push it to the left, but with the smaller force because it's a bit farther away. So now we can say that the total force on wire A is equal to the force from wire B plus the force from wire C. And then it's going to the left. So this equation that I wrote down gives us the force per unit length, but thankfully they tell us that we are considering the force on 4 meters of wire A. So the length we're talking about is just 4 meters.
Yeah.
And so if I multiply L to the other side, the force from wire B is equal to mu naught times L. I1 is the current in wire A, which they said is just I. And the same current is actually in all three wires. So I1 is I, I2 is also I, so I get I squared, divided by 2 pi times A, which is the distance between the two wires. They also told us that wire B is a distance 2R to the right of wire A. So here's the force from wire B. Now we add the force from wire C, which is going to be the same thing, L mu naught I squared over 2 pi, but this time the distance is 3R. The wire C is 2R plus an extra R away from wire A. And so with L being 4 meters, mu is given to you. The current I is 24 amps, also given to you. 2 pi 2, R is 5 millimeters. So we have everything we need, and this should be the answer when you actually plug these numbers in. This process theory, yeah.
So, in an exam, would they change, like, if the wires were coming, like, in or out, like, if they were all the same, then, like, if instead of going to the left, it would go to the right?
Yes. Okay. Or you could have wire C be going into the page, and that way wire C is going to attract A while wire B pushes A away, and that instead of adding the two forces, you subtract.
Okay, but it would still go to the left then because...
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't think I have any more problems like this, but I made this with you, I think, a long time ago, and she has since put these wire force problems on free response in some cases. So if you guys did a problem like this in class, No? If you did it, then actually, it'll just be... Yeah. They're all going in, they're going to the trap. So it would still be added, but it would work. Yeah. Good. Any other questions on this one? Yes.
Just on the last one, if we were just looking at B, would the two forces of the force A and force C still be added together?
So force C is going to attract, and then force A is going to push it away. They'd still be.
Okay, but it would like change. We were looking at like wire C, then probably A would be subtracted with it.
Yeah. So if we looked at the force of wire C, B would attract it, or. Yeah, B would attract it and A would push it away, and so they would be subtracted. Yeah. Well done. Okay, I do have another force problem, I guess. This one is kind of similar to what we did with magnetic fields here. Also kind of not, just that it's in the shape of a triangle. Yeah. So they all carry the same current into the or coming out of the page. What is the force on wire J due to the other wires? Or what's the direction? So based on the attraction or repulsion principles that we were just talking about, is wire K going to attract or repel J?
Attract.
Attract. And then is wire L going to attract or repel?
Attract.
So here's F. F came. And so the net force is just straight down. And that should be all there is to it. So you can see already from what the 5 problems we've done, directionality is asked for a lot, just because we're working with cross products and lots of vector quantities in this part of the class. So be prepared for stuff like that. Alright, that should all be easy money. This one is not free money actually at all. So let's go ahead and do this. This is one of the old free response problems. So I think you guys did an in-class assignment on the net magnetic field due to some wires. Maybe it was in like that L shape or something. That sound right? Or an infinite line of wires. She doesn't usually use that equation with like sine of theta. I don't think that's on the equation sheet, so that's not going to be on the test. And if it is, I'm really sorry. But I really don't think that's on the test. She usually just speaks with straight wires. But there's going to be more than one, so you're going to have to know how to add these magnetic fields. So let's start with drawing what I typed up on there. There's two wires in a plane. And they're both on the y-axis. Right, so one is at the point. We have one wire at the point x equals 0, y equals 10 centimeters. That's here. And then another wire at the origin. Does it say another one's at the origin? Yeah. Okay. We need to know whether the current flows in the same direction or opposite direction, and which one flows in which direction. So what they give us is where the wires are located, but also that the net magnetic field is pointing in the negative x direction at the point halfway between the wire. Here is the net magnetic field. These are two wires. I haven't filled in which one's going into the page or out, or neither of them are going into the page. We have to determine whether their magnetic fields are going in the same direction or not, and which one's doing which. So let's think of possible ways to form this magnetic field. And also keep in mind that they carry equal currents. So there's only four possible options. They're both going in, or they're both going out. And one's going in, one's going out, and that can happen two different ways. So we'll just try them all. Let's pretend that the bottom wire is going, the bottom current's going into the plane of the whiteboard. So we put our thumb in that direction, and it seems like the magnetic field is going to the right. And then if we put this one in also, that magnetic field would be going to the left, and those would counteract each other, and we would get no magnetic field. So that's not a possible configuration. And after that trial, it seems like this one's doing the right thing going into the page, because it's creating a magnetic field that goes to the left. To have this one help out, we're going to have its current go out of the page and the curl of our fingers is also going to the left. So this is coming out, and this is going in. Did you guys see any of that?
Yeah.
So is everyone clear why, after I've given you what the current configuration is, can you see how this creates a magnetic field going to the left? Which one? No problem. The top one is going in. So the question was, would this top one create a magnetic field going to the left if its current was going out of the page? It would if we would care about the point up here. But when we come all the way down, it's pointing to the right. So yeah, we care about the magnetic field between these two points. I answered part A and part B at the same time just by trying different configurations. They're going in the opposite direction, and the direction of the current that flows to the origin is coming out of the board. I guess I call that positive Z direction in this way. Okay? Is there still, I can go over this very slowly if there's still questions about it. But also there's the right hand rule video. Please watch that. Okay, now we have to actually do some calculation and find out the magnitude of the current. So this is the same question that was on the board last slide. Just part C is different. So one thing that was given to us was it 9 microteslas? The magnetic field is 9 microteslas. And we have to find the current through the wires. They both have the same current I, so we don't need to worry about two of them. But just from looking at the spectral quantity, we know that the magnetic field, the network, is a contribution from both of these. This bottom current coming out of the page creates a magnetic field going to the left. I'm going to call this 1 and 2. So it's equal to B1, but also the current from the second, or the magnetic field from the second current helps it out and goes in the same direction. So it's plus B2. And then we were told these are infinite wires. And there's an equation for an infinite wires magnetic field on the sheet. And it's mu naught times I over 2 pi times the distance between them, between the current and the point you're talking about. So this right here is that distance A. So this is from, let's say, the bottom current. It happens to be, since they have the same current I, and the point is halfway between them, that they're both the same distance A apart. And so this just becomes 2 mu not I over 2 pi. That's equal to 9 microteslas, which is what they told us was the net magnetic field. Mu naught is just a number. A is halfway between the two points in consideration. They told us that this current above the origin is at y equals 10 centimeters. And so then A is just 5 centimeters. And for this, we get I is equal to, these twos go away, I times A over mu naught times the magnetic field, which is now microtesla. And this should be a number by the end of the day. But I think this problem is somewhat atypical because she usually cares more about finding the magnetic field. And in this problem, she gave it to us and we had to find it her. So it's kind of an exotic way of formulating this type of questions. But it's going, whether she asks for the magnetic field or she asks for the current, you're going to have to apply the same concept. You're going to have to know what the magnetic field due to an infinite current is. That's the mu naught I over 2 pi A. And you're going to have to use that right-hand rule to get some directionality out of it. All right, 1.13 amps it is. And I think there's 2 more in this part of the review, and then we'll move on to Kirchhoff's laws. I think I threw this one in last minute. And actually, I'm going to skip it. But I'll tell you what the key thing to take away from this is you have the force on a charged particle is qv cross v. But it tells you it's in a circular, it's undergoing some type of circular motion. So that's equal to mass times acceleration. But acceleration is v squared over r. Let's keep, it's not set vectors equal to scalars. So from this, it might even be given to you on your equation sheet, but your particle is going to, or your charge is going to move in a circle. And that circle is going to have some radius. The radius is equal to mv over the charge times the magnetic field. This is when v and b are perpendicular. So this usually comes, these type of problems come in a few flavors, as many flavors as there are variables in this equation. So they could ask for the radius of this circular orbit. They could give you the radius and ask for the mass, everything else given. They could ask for the magnetic field, the velocity, the charge. So any of these letters is able to be asked in a question like this, but it all goes to the same concept. That the radius is the mass times the velocity over the charge times the magnetic field. So go ahead and you can try this this one at home on your free time. That's a whole time at home. Yeah. Okay, so now we actually have a question. But what is the question talking about? It gives us a loop with the resistor. else that there's 100 turns on it. Magnetic field that is into the plane of the future. Where's my head? So this loop exists in a magnetic field. And the magnetic field is going into the plane. And it is a sinusoidal magnetic field. Oh no! That might have been a problem you guys did. It's a polynomial. Alpha minus, is it minus? Beta t squared. That's the magnitude of the magnetic field, and it's going into the plane of the page. They give us alpha and beta. First, we need to calculate the magnetic flux. Also the radius, what's the radius, 1.4?
Yeah.
So I mean? Okay, magnetic flux. So, you guys are given this equation for magnetic flux. And I think that might be all you're given. But this is all you're going to ever use. But unless you're a physics major, you're going to use worse stuff than that. So you're not going to have to do any integrals on this test. This strict definition reduces to this in the stuff we did last class. And even, I'd say 99% of this time, theta is equal to zero. And so you end up just getting b times a. But that cosine of theta is an angle between the magnetic field and the area. The magnetic field is going into the page. And the area element is always perpendicular to whatever area you're talking about. So that's either coming out of the page or in. And either way, cosine is 1 or negative 1, and it doesn't contribute anything to magnitude. Yeah?
How do we know what theta is equal to 0?
So yeah, just what I was saying. So theta is, this is the angle between the magnetic field and the area vector. Which way is the magnetic field going? Into the page? The area vector is always perpendicular to the area that you're talking about. The area we're talking about is this board right here. So the area is either going in or coming out. And we somewhat get a choice. And if we choose it to also be going in, theta is just 0 degrees. When theta is not 0 degrees, you're basically going to be explicitly told the angle between the magnetic field and the area is theta equals blank. And then you'll know that you need that. Other than that, don't worry about it. So using this, you guys see that? That's just B times A over there. We get that the magnetic flux is equal to B alpha, which is alpha minus beta t squared, times the area of whatever we're talking about. In this case, it's a circle, just pi r squared. That's the flux at any time. In this part of the problem, they ask, what's the flux at time t equals 0? And then you just plug t equals 0 in there. So we'll just substitute t 0. This goes away. And we just get alpha pi r squared. And since I don't have this on the slide, I'll write that for you. It's going to be 0.045. This is like, this is a big step. The flux is the magnetic field times the area. If you can get the magnetic field, in this case it was given, all you have to know is what area you're talking about. And part B of the problem is, at time t equals 60, the induced current is 0.022 amps. What is the resistance in the loop? So anytime they mention current, or resistance in this problem, you should be using the classic Ohm's law that we learned, epsilon is equal to IR. So the induced EMF is equal to induced current times the resistance. That's always going to show up. This is something we have to use eventually. First, we need the induced EMF. And from that, we get, or we look at our equation sheet, and we find out that it's equal to, in magnitude, the time derivative of the flux. And then multiply by the number of loops that we have. So there's going to be an induced EMF in each loop, and if you have n loops, you get n times that amount of EMF. So then the difficult part of these problems becomes taking the derivative of a polynomial, and that should be a piece of cake for everyone, because flux at any time is just a quadratic. So this is going to be magnitude of negative n times the derivative of that function is negative 2 beta t times pi r squared. And that's all you have to do. So we get 2 pi r squared and beta times t. This is the EMF. But we're asked for the resistance. So from this equation, we get R is equal to the EMF divided by the current. So if we divide by the current, we should get the resistance. And it's important to note that they said explicitly that time was equal to 60 seconds when all this occurred. And so R is the radius, and is the 100 turns that occurred in the problem. Theta is a number that was given, 60 seconds, and they gave us the induced current. What we should end up getting is 10.1 ohms. And then the last part of the problem is, already circled for it, but we should still try to reason through it. What is the direction of the induced current in the loop? So, for that we use Lenz's law. Once again, please watch that video. You're going to have to know Lenz's law for the test in some way. There's probably going to be a question explicitly on it, among it being a side part in some of these questions. So, we have to know if the Lenz's law is the magnetic field, or is the magnetic flux changing? And And that comes from two options. Either our magnetic field is changing, because the flux is the magnetic field times the area, or our area is changing. And in this case, it's the magnetic field that is polynomial. So is this magnetic field increasing or decreasing? I heard someone say decreasing. Right, we took the derivative, it'd be negative. So we have a decreasing magnetic field. So the magnetic field is decreasing, and it's going into the page. So the goal of Lenz's law, or the end goal of what the induced current should do, is it should create a magnetic field that opposes the change. So if we're decreasing into the page, what should our current do in order to oppose that change? Should it create a current going in or out of the page? It should be in. But I heard people say out, so watch that video. So the change is the decrease. If we want to oppose the change, we want to oppose that decrease and help out the magnetic field. And so our induced magnetic field should be into the page. And then what type of current will create a magnetic field that goes in? Clockwise or counterclockwise? Let's see, we need it going in. And no matter where I am on this circle, the current is going in this clockwise direction. Hopefully it's the answer. So, of course you have a 50-50 chance of yes, but if you know Lenz's law, this should be free. Alright, and this is without a doubt going to be a free response question. Obviously not this one specifically, but without a doubt, you're going to have to do something like this where you find the induced EMF, the induced current, and then say which way the induced magnetic field is going, or which way the induced current is going. And you have two examples of a problem like this from class today. I'll go back to the yeah.
Okay, so how would you get the question?
For which part of the problem?
For
part B? Yeah, it was actually given. So it says at time t equals 60, the induced current is 0.022 amp. Yeah. I suspect that she will be asking you for the induced current or the induced EMF instead of the resistance. That's kind of confusing. So I know I didn't delete these slides. Oh, here it is. I put the dog too early. Oh, don't worry about it. Alright, Lenz's law. This is the one problem I'm going to do, and she actually addressed it in class today. Because in the video, I think I cover almost every possible way it could happen, and then she put this one on the test, and this is not in the video. So I threw this one in here. But she talked about it today in class. So we have a current going to the left, and we have a loop that is falling away from the current. We're asked which way is the induced current in that loop. So the current is to the left. Here's our loop. So first thing first, before we can apply Lenz's law, we have to know what this magnetic field is doing. If this current is going to the left, we can come in the direction of the current. If our fingers loop around, once we get here, the magnetic field is coming out of the board. So this should be the magnetic field. And then the property of this field is the farther away you get from the current, the weaker that magnetic field is going to be. So when this loop starts falling, the magnetic flux starts decreasing because the magnetic field gets weaker the farther away you are from that. So if we have a decreasing flux and the magnetic field is going out of the page, which way do we need to make an induced magnetic field to close the chain? Should it go into the page or out of the page? I think I heard everyone say out. All right, that's really good. So it should be coming out of the page. So here's the induced magnetic field. And that's because this flux is decreasing. We need to help out that magnetic field in order for it to be satisfied with some sort of equilibrium. So we help it out by making a magnetic field also going out. And what direction should the current be then to create this magnetic field? Counterclockwise. Was that what was here? This makes sense? There's like another six examples in that video. And that should be easier. Yeah. Okay. What time is it? 7:15? I always like plan this whole stuff to talk about, but there's never enough time. I'm still gonna talk about it. So that answer was supposed to be a pop-up, but I'm asking what's the difference between an electric field and a magnetic field. Well, if we look at what you guys learned in this class, is if you have a current, here's the current line. There's a bunch of charged particles in that current moving, and the collection of those moving charges creates a magnetic field. And we end up getting a magnetic field that's out of the board here, and into the board, and then loops around. Well, what if you were the electron inside that current? What would you end up seeing? So if you shifted your reference frame and you hopped on the magic school bus and shrunk down to the size of an electron, rode on its back, you would think you're just sitting still and the rest of the world is moving around you. It's like if you're in a car and you don't know the car is moving, you can't look outside, you're in an inertial reference frame, you don't know whether you're actually moving or not unless you see things moving relative to you. Does that relativity principle make sense? So the electron thinks it's sitting still. And when you have a charge sitting still in space, you just see an electric field. So this is the same event. If we're sitting out here looking at the current, we have magnets being attracted and weird things happening with magnetic fields. But if we're the electron, we're just hanging out in an electric field. And so the class electricity and magnetism is actually just called electromagnetism because they're two sides of the same coin depending on the way you look at it. And so instead of having two vectors with three components each, you get like a rank two tensor with nine components, and it's all crazy. But this is Einstein's big, or the start of his big discoveries was recognizing this fact. Is that okay? Is that kind of cool?
Yes,
that's cool. Anyways, physics 473, if I haven't advertised that enough, take that. So we'll take a 5-minute break and maybe I'll just talk if 5 minutes. There's only like 3 problems left after this, and that's it. She's a hairstylist in LA, and she bought, like, rented out a private island where this windmill is located in the Netherlands. So I don't know what her annual income is. That is a question I should ask. And then now she's in Italy right now, not on a private island. She's with others. But, these are some people. I was invited to the wedding, but I'm a civilian, so I didn't get to buy a plane ticket to go. Also, I was in Denver the week before. I should have been here. Here's the problem we were just doing. Oh, I didn't mention this. I think one of the 2 tests is going to have this problem. You guys saw this in class, right? This uses an equation not seen, never before seen on the equation sheet. But you guys have seen this before, right? Including today. This should be memorized. Memorize that. It's special to this case. So that's when you have the bar on that little circuit. And it's moving, there's a magnetic field there. This is the induced EMF. There's a magnetic field times the length of that rod times the velocity.
What video?
Oh, this isn't a video, yeah. It should say induction. Electromagnetic induction. Induction? Yeah. Did I say see the video? Okay, good. See the video. Yeah.
So on the homework third one, you have to find the force to push it in a certain velocity.
Force to push it in a certain velocity?
Yeah, the velocity.
You can calculate it.
Yeah. I think you derived it on the homework. Yeah. You end up deriving it. Force. There's a current in that magnetic, rod right there, isn't there? And there's a magnetic field existing in that plane. If you have a current and a magnetic field, there's going to be a force. You just need to set that force large enough in order for it to actually apply. We can talk about your thoughts. Or after that. Oh god, I have more pictures. What was I? Maybe things were appropriately placed. Alright, we got 15. Yeah. So this is a really somewhat embarrassing story, but my girlfriend kind of looks like a squirrel. She's in this room, so you can find her. Anyways, I won't go into more details. I'm not saying she is a squirrel. She just has squirrel characters. But, anyways, I sent her, I saw a squirrel in a park. I had my friend take a picture. This was when I was in Denver instead of the wedding. And I sent her this picture, thinking like, oh, I'm being pretty cute, right? And the squirrel ended up being male. I'm not saying she's a male. I'm saying she looks like a squirrel. Okay. That's all the introductions. Okay, so the majority of the test is magnetism. Magnetic fields due to current, forces on current, magnetic forces on charges, the induction problem is it. But I think a quarter of it is on this intro to circuits type stuff. And these are going to be similar problems to the capacitance stuff you had in the last exam, except wherever you see a capacitor, you're going to see a resistor this time. And you're going to be asked certain questions about that. So here's a, this is a typical multiple choice question. It's a simple circuit with a collection of resistors. What's the current through one of the resistors? So if you remember last test, you would give, be given a simple circuit with some capacitors, and they'd say, what is the charge stored on capacitor two? So similar stuff, but now we know the rules for resistors are kind of reverse than for capacitors. So let me draw this real quick. Is that it? 10, 10, 10, 25. Elements are in parallel, which of them are in series, and combine stuff accordingly. So let's start right here, let's travel the current along. We get to this junction, we have to make a choice. So we know this section and this section are in parallel. They're definitely not in series, because there's a split. Let me go down this path. There's one resistor, two resistor, three resistors, and then I get to another junction again. And I have to make a choice. That tells me that these three here, not that one, these three on this right side are in series. And so I can combine those. I'm just going to combine those into one. And the equivalent resistance of three resistors in series is just the sum of their individual resistances. So I should get 30 ohms. So after combining, I have a bit of a simpler circuit. And then I do the same thing. I find that these two are clearly in parallel with each other. And so I can combine those two. This was the old combination. So after combining those, the equivalent resistance is then 1 over the individual resistance, the sum of those, and then go ahead and put that to the power of -1, and you get the equivalent, which combining procedure makes sense so far. Very similar to capacitors, we flip the rules. And then the last step is to combine these two. These are clearly in series, and I just add them together. To get 17 volts, or excuse me, 17 ohms. As my total resistance for this circuit. And then if I want the current in this stage, say that the total current is equal to epsilon over the total resistance. We were given that the battery's voltage is 11 volts, and we found that the total resistance is 17 ohms. And that ends up being 0.65. The other question that I'm going to say. So that's the current through the 17 ohm resistor that we created through manipulation. Is that the same as the current through this 5 ohm resistor? I have yeses and noes. What do you think? It is. Exactly. So this is the total current in this circuit, no matter what configuration we're in. If we look at this initial configuration, we have the current. It splits, does whatever it wants. Here, it combines, and the current that goes through this 5-ohm resistor is the total current that is inside this circuit. So we should get that the current through the 5-ohm resistor is the 0.65 amps that we have. And that's because it's in a spot where it gets all of the current. Any questions? This is multiple choice territory for sure. I'll leave this one to you guys for the sake of time because there's a Kirchhoff problem that we have to do. So it asks which light bulb is the brightest, and that's just asking which light bulb gets the most current. You're going to treat all those light bulbs as having the same resistance and just call it R. So the light bulb is just a fancy resistor that lights up when it does its resistance. And the answer is going to be A. A is going to get the most current. Here's another trick problem I'll go over real quick. So this showed up on a test and scared a lot of people. So we have a battery, and then we have a lot of these configurations. What's the equivalent resistance for this entire packet? Well, all we have to do is find the red marker that's in my hand. And if we find out the equivalent resistance of just one of these, we know that the entire row of them are in series, and we can just add them all together, which is the same as multiplying by n because we have n of these packets of four. So this is one of those packs. If we simplify it, we see these top two and bottom two are in series with each other. They all have resistance R. Combining the top two, we have 2R on top. The bottom two, we have 2R on bottom. And then the last step is to combine these in parallel. And this becomes 1 over 2R plus 1 over 2R. So there's a negative 1, which is, what is it? Just R. So this is the equivalent for one packet. So that's just straight up combining resistors. And so now instead of this picture, what I actually have is battery, and a set of resistors in series with resistance R. So the total, if I combine these, is just N times R. Because combining resistors in series is the same as adding them all up. We have N of them, we're just multiplying by N. Is this okay? But more questions on this? Let's see. So beware of a trick question, and this looks much more complicated than it turned out to be. And here we are at the main event. So let's do this one. We're definitely going to be past 7:30, but I'll make sure it's no more than 10 minutes past. And this is your free response problem. I'm guessing it's the second one. No, maybe it's a third one. But this is a free response problem. It's going to be Kirchhoff's loop rules and Kirchhoff's junction rules. You're going to be given a pretty big circuit, possibly with multiple batteries. And we have to follow this step-by-step, menu-driven approach to be able to get the current. And in this case, we actually need to find the resistance R. And beyond this problem, I have a video on a Kirchhoff's rule problem that was on a previous test also, where you just had to solve for all the currents. And that one is seen most often. But this has showed up as well. So let's go ahead and knock it out, and we can get out of here. Okay, these problems follow the same step-by-step procedure basically every time. Step one is you need to do the junction rule. This is where we pick some currents, some directions for the currents, and relate them in some way. Well, the problem already told us that I is going up, so we'll just choose I to go up. And then I'm also going to choose upon I1 going that way, and then I'm going to choose I3 to go that way. And so you can choose any combination of directions you want, as long as it makes sense. Things that are not allowed is if we have a junction, we can't have all the currents going into the same spot, because that doesn't make any sense physically. Nor can we have everything going out of one spot. So the amount of currents going in and going out has to be physically possible in some sense. And we see that is the case here. We have I1 going in. We have I going in, and out we get I3. That tells us that I1 plus I is equal to I3. So if you do not get a junction rule for these currents, you won't be able to solve for any of the variables in these problems. This has to be step one. And step two are the loop rules. this is where we pick some loops, traverse them, and use Kirchhoff's law that says if you make a complete loop in a current or in a circuit, the potential difference overall is going to be zero. So I'm going to choose my currents or my loops to be this one, and I'm going to go around it counterclockwise, and I'm going to choose another loop to also go counterclockwise. Here's loop one, here's loop two. You can choose any loops you want. I just chose those two because I think they're going to be the easiest. But we'll start with loop one, and I'll start right here. Right away, loop one, I know once I get back to my initial spot, the change of potential is going to be zero. So I travel along the circuit, I reach a battery, I'm going to positive to negative. That's going to be a voltage drop of minus 30. If I were going the other way, it would have been a voltage jump. And then I1 is going this way, so down here, this is still at 1. I reach this 10 ohm resistor. I'm traveling my loop this way, but the current I label is going the other way. That's going to be a voltage increase of plus I times R, times R, which is 10. Then my loop is the center one. I continue along. I get to another resistor with a current I. This time I'm going the same direction as the current I labeled. That's going to be minus IR. Minus I times 20. Then I hit this battery. I get a voltage jump plus 50. So I'm going the right way this time from negative to positive. And I get back to my starting point. And all of this should equal zero. And then I'm going to traverse my next loop, which is this outer one here. So I'll start right here. And which way am I going? So I'm going this way. So actually, I'll start here. So starting here, traveling down, I have a resistor and this current I3. I'm going the same direction as the current, so it's minus I3 times R. And I'm not doing anything. Here I reach resistor. Is it going to be minus or plus? Minus. I'm going the same way as the current. So minus I1 times R. In this case, R is told to be 10 ohms. And then as I travel more, I reach a battery going from negative to positive. Is this a voltage jump or a drop? Jump, plus 30. And I get back to where I started, and I reset it equals zero. So these are my two loop equations. This is how you're going to set up the problem for the test. And I think this setup already is probably going to be the majority of the points. Because the rest of it is just algebra. And she wants you to be able to do algebra, but she really doesn't care. And so she'll knock the pointer too off me. So if you can set it up, you're going to be in the golden territory. So let's go ahead and solve. We want to solve for what I and
so why for the first loop did we go around the way that we did?
That's the way I chose.
Oh, so you can choose either
way. Choose whichever way you want to go around. So you have to handle things accordingly. So if I went around and the current is going the opposite direction, and I'm going and it's positive.
Or,
yeah.
Gotcha.
What are you saying? Yeah. Those are arbitrary. Even the current directions are arbitrary. That's another point to highlight is when you choose your current, what's going to happen is you're going to go through all the algebra, you're going to get an answer at the end. If your current is negative, not all hope is lost. It usually just means you chose the wrong direction. So if we solve and we find out I1 is negative, it just means that I1 was actually going to the left at the top instead of to the right, like I said. It doesn't mean that the number is wrong. I mean, it could mean that, but it doesn't have to. And the direction of the loop doesn't matter at all. Anyway, you choose them. Yeah?
How do you choose the loop?
Just chose them. So flip a coin, bring a coin to the test, and then you choose one. So let's see, what do we have here? I don't know. A few of these. I think we need one more loop. Oh, okay. This is actually perfect. So we set this up, and this is like my worst computer. They actually gave us that I is equal to 1.5. Whatever. Yeah, that's what I said. That's not what I said. Yeah. If you weren't given I, if you did the whole outside loop, you'd have to do that other loop on the right side. Yeah, because we have four unknowns right now as it stands without I. But since I is given, we're in business. So I is given. So if we plug I into here, we get I1 for free. So this first loop rule I have has I in it, but we know that. So the rest of the numbers we solve for I1. And I think I have that number. Don't worry about that, it's not true. It's a lie. So I is given, and you get I1 is equal to 2.5. Oh, this one is equal to 1.0.
That's what it said.
Huh?
That's what it said.
Yeah, so what we actually, what it had to find, this I is given.
Yeah, but it said I1 is A.
Yeah, it's the way I worded it. If you want to, I can show you the question afterward. This I1 is equal to 1A. Does that work out? That does work out. And then once we have I1 and I, we have 1 plus 1.5, so I3 is equal to 2.5 amps. So we'll box that one. And then lastly, in this equation, we know I3 now, we know I1, and we can solve for R. From this, you get that R is equal to 8 ohms. Problem set find I, it meant the current through the 10 ohm resistor, and that number is 1. So, okay, that's all I got. Hopefully this will be posted. tomorrow morning. Definitely not doing it tonight.
Like a first off call, you have to get done most of the time.
Yeah, you only have three. Thank you, love.
You made me cry when you said goodbye. Is that a shame? My tears feel like rain.